Hi folks, I'm Dr. Chapman. Let's explore Grand Canyon National Park to learn about unconformities and how sometimes the clues to unlocking the history of our planet are not in the rock record, but in the absence of it. The Grand Canyon is one of the best places to understand and experience stratigraphy. It beautifully illustrates the principle of original horizontality, the concept that sedimentary rocks are originally deposited in flat-lying horizontal layers. It also demonstrates the law of superposition, which states that sedimentary rock layers are deposited in a sequence with the oldest on the bottom and the youngest on the top.
Newbies on top!
The oldest rocks in the Grand Canyon are 1.7 billion-year-old Proterozoic metamorphic rocks like the Vishnu Schist, which is exposed along the Colorado River. The youngest rocks in the Grand Canyon are 270 million-year-old Permian limestones belonging to the Kaibab Formation that are exposed at the rim of the canyon. If you drive north from the Grand Canyon to Zion National Park, you encounter an even younger part of the stratigraphy. At Zion, the oldest exposed rocks are part of the Kaibab Formation, and the youngest are 120 million-year-old Early Cretaceous sandstone and conglomerate, part of the Cedar Mountain Formation. It's exposed along the various highest locations within the park. All of the rocks exposed at Zion National Park were also deposited as flat-lying layers above the present-day Grand Canyon area, before there was a canyon. But those layers have all been eroded away. In arid climates, limestone is relatively resistant to erosion.
It's definitely phasor resistant.
This is why the Kaibab Formation, which is mainly limestone, forms a vast plain above the Grand Canyon and also forms a cliff at the rim of the Grand Canyon. Other cliff faces in the Grand Canyon are made of erosionally resistant layers like the Mississippian Age Redwall limestone. Layers that form gentle slopes or benches in the Grand Canyon are made of less resistant rock layers like the Cambrian Bright Angel Shale and the Pennsylvanian Age Supai Group. Although the Grand Canyon contains a beautiful pile of sedimentary rocks, there are time gaps in the rock record that are missing called unconformities. There are three main flavors of unconformities, and the Grand Canyon has all of them.
It took me a couple of years to collect them all.
The first type is called a nonconformity. And forms when sedimentary rocks are deposited on top of older metamorphic or igneous rocks. Metamorphic rocks and intrusive igneous rocks form underground, deep within the earth, whereas sedimentary rocks are deposited at the surface of the earth. So geologists can deduce that there was some event that eroded down or otherwise brought up the deep metamorphic and igneous rocks up to the surface of the earth. Such events usually take a lot of time, millions of years. And that time is what is recorded by the nonconformity.
I'm such a nonconformist.
In the Grand Canyon, the boundary between the 1.7 billion-year-old metamorphic rocks, like the Vishnu Schist, and 1.2 billion-year-old sedimentary rocks in the Grand Canyon supergroup is a nonconformity. This nonconformity represents half a billion years of missing time in the rock record. The second type of unconformity is called a disconformity, and this is the most boring and most difficult type to recognize. A disconformity represents a period of erosion or non-deposition between parallel layers of sedimentary rocks. In the Grand Canyon, there's a disconformity between the Cambrian Muav limestone and the Mississippian Redwall limestone, where more than 150 million years of time are missing. But it's hard to tell because both limestones look very similar.
He's not Fred, I am. Honestly, woman, you call yourself our mother.
One way to tell them apart would be to identify age diagnostic fossils in the rocks. For example, trilobites are common in the Cambrian period, but uncommon in younger periods. Conversely, bryozoans are not present in the Cambrian, but common in younger rocks. Trilobites are common in the Muav limestone, but are rare in the Redwall limestone. And bryozoans can be found in the Redwall limestone, but not in the Muav limestone. This is an example of using biostratigraphy to date the layers of rock. Another way to recognize the Muav Redwall disconformity is to hike along and closely examine the contact between the two formations. In some places, there are thin lenses of Devonian Age sedimentary rocks called the Temple Butte Formation. These lenses were deposited in ancient channels that were eroded or carved into the Muav limestone during the missing time period.
And I'm missing $9.
This gives us a clue that perhaps streams and rivers eroded into the landscape during the Devonian to create the disconformity. The third and last type of unconformity is an angular unconformity, and it is the photogenic darling of geoscientists everywhere. An angular unconformity is where older sedimentary rock layers were tilted or folded and eroded, and then new flat-lying sediments were deposited on top. The Great Unconformity in the Grand Canyon is an angular unconformity, and it is arguably the most famous angular unconformity on Earth. It separates the Cambrian Tapete sandstone from the Grand Canyon supergroup in Vishnu Schist. Depending on the exact location, the Great Unconformity represents up to a billion years of missing time. The Great Unconformity is not just present in the Grand Canyon, but can be observed all over the world as one of the most widely recognized and distinctive stratigraphic surfaces. Geoscientists debate what caused the Great Unconformity.
Sometimes they're caused by emotions.
But the leading hypotheses are either regional tectonic uplift and erosion during the formation of the supercontinent Rodinia, which is similar to the supercontinent Pangaea but formed 500 million years earlier. Or the second hypothesis is a global glaciation. Continental ice sheets and glaciers are effective agents of erosion, and they can also cause sea level to drop as water is removed from the ocean and added to glaciers on land. Today, the opposite is happening as glaciers on land are melting due to global warming and sea level is rising. As sea level drops during a global glaciation, areas of the continents that were once covered by water and protected by the oceans are now exposed to the air and subject to erosion.
Doesn't that constitute indecent exposure?
Geologists have theorized that the extended period of erosion and continental denudation associated with the Great Unconformity may have caused some pretty strange events, like the formation of a snowball Earth. If you've watched the video on Joshua Tree National Park, you'll know that weathering and erosion of rocks breaks down minerals like feldspar into more basic elements and releases cations like calcium into streams and rivers. The dissolved calcium makes its way into the groundwater and eventually into the oceans. Calcium likes to bond with carbonate, which forms when carbon dioxide is dissolved in water. The mineral produced is called calcium carbonate or calcite, which is the main mineral that limestone is made of. If you've ever seen a stalactite hanging from a cave ceiling, that is calcite precipitating out of the water. So, long story short, weathering and erosion releases cations that help to suck carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and lock it away in a rock form.
This time you'll never get out.
As you know, carbon dioxide is the most important greenhouse gas. The erosion that created the Great Unconformity was so widespread and intense that it may have pulled enough carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere to have caused the entire Earth to be covered in ice, a condition affectionately called Snowball Earth. It sounds bizarre, but geologists believe that a snowball Earth entirely covered by glaciers existed multiple times in Earth's history. Another fantastical event in Earth history that may be linked to the Great Unconformity is the Cambrian Explosion. About 540 million years ago, practically all major animal evolutionary lineages suddenly appeared in the fossil record. Before the Cambrian Explosion, organisms were simple single-celled organisms or basic cellular colonies and were mainly soft-bodied.
Soft and loose.
After the explosion, skeletonized animals appear. Not internal skeletons yet, animals with shells. So why did animals with shells suddenly appear on the evolutionary scene? Well, these shells are mainly made of calcium carbonate. It's possible that during the extreme weathering and erosion associated with the Great Unconformity, that the amount of calcium in the oceans increased dramatically, which may have hastened the evolution of biomineralization and adaptation like shells and hard body parts. Humans and our hard body parts, our skeletons, are the direct ancestors of the animals that appeared during the Cambrian Explosion. And perhaps you and everyone you know owes their very existence to the Great Unconformity.
Hey, thanks for watching. Check out some more videos and share them with friends and family. Take care.